Hi everyone and welcome. It's been a while since I posted an MCE Blaster video and things have changed quite a bit, so here we go. If you're not familiar with the project, here's a quick overview. The MCE Blaster is a DIY adapter that converts TTL video, MDA Hercules, CGA and EGA to analog VGA. This means that you can use it, for example, to plug in your old XT machine to any VGA monitor without the need for an upscaler. What is great about the MCE Blaster is that it is quite inexpensive to put together. You can make one yourself for a total cost of around $20. That is $4 for the Pico, around $6 for the connectors and the rest of the components, and around $10 for a PCB from an online fab. Okay, now that you know what the MCE Blaster is, let's look at some of the issues. As you may recall from the last video, the MCE Blaster uses a fairly sophisticated sampling method that matches the input TTL signal's pixel clock frequency. But in Hercules mode, you could still see some artifacts, at least with my specific video card. Some MCE Blaster users ran into similar issues and filed a bug report on the project's page on GitHub. And by the way, many thanks to all of you who report bugs and help with testing. This project wouldn't have made it so far without all your help. So thank you all so much. Now let's get back to the sampling issue. As you can see, you can't get rid of the sampling artifacts at the borders. But let's go back and take a closer look into what is going on. Let's try to adjust the MCE Blaster's pixel clock to get a good image. Initially, the sampling pixel clock is at 16.180 MHz, which is way off. This results in three noisy vertical bands. The noise corresponds to when we're sampling pixels during their transition. So in some cases we sample the previous pixel, and in some cases we sample the next. Increasing the pixel clock to 16.200 MHz reduces the noise bands to just 2. At 16.240 MHz, we only have 1. Now let's increase the pixel clock 1 MHz at a time. Between 16.252 and 16.268 MHz, the whole image is noisy. And finally, at 16.269 MHz, we are back to a single noisy band. So what is going on here? Shouldn't we have got a good image by now? Let's get back to the frequencies where the whole image was noisy. What's happening here is that the sampling clock of the Pico matches the video's pixel clock, but all pixels are being sampled at their transition. So at these sampling frequencies, we should have got a perfect image, and we don't, because sampling happens to match the pixel transitions. But this is easy to fix, we just need to delay sampling by a bit, and we should get a perfect image. This is exactly what this new sampling offset feature does. It shifts the sampling clock such that we can avoid the pixel transitions. So let's try to tune the image once again, this time using the firmware with the sampling offset feature. We start with a single noisy band. Then at 16.252 MHz, we can pretty much get a perfect image by adjusting the offset. There are many other features and improvements that have been added to the latest firmware. These include a menu line that is shown in the foreground while the background is still showing live video, a TTL info screen which shows some basic information about the input video signal, a manual TTL mode where you can disable video auto detection and force specific video mode and other parameters. This is particularly useful for non-standard video modes like those in scientific instruments. Fixes related to border pixels being cropped in some video modes. Fixes related to compatibility with some VGA monitors. Profiles for saving your settings in case you are frequently swapping video cards. and many others. Finally, some people have requested a way to reproduce the effect of an amber or a green phosphorus monochrome monitor, and others have requested a way to adjust the hotness or voltage of the VGA signal. Well, the new PCB design will make both happy, as it provides three optional trimmers for adjusting each VGA red, green and blue channels independently. Let's put it together. Oh, and some users have reported that the footprint for the 15-pin VGA connector was not a good fit for some of the widely available VGA connectors. And indeed, when I tried to use this larger connector on the revision 0.2 PCB, the pins wouldn't line up, so I had to bend them slightly. In the newer PCB revision, I have increased the size of the drill holes of the footprint, so it should accommodate both connector types just fine. The theoretical values for the DAC circuit resistors is 390 and 780 ohms, but I didn't have these values, so I used 470 and 1 kilo ohms respectively. This will make the image a bit darker than it should be. Okay, let's try it out. Oh, the image is very dark. It must be the potentiometer. Yeah, much better now. To recreate the amber phosphorus effect with MDA input, you can just turn down the blue channel. For the green phosphorus effect, you just turn down both red and blue. Oh, and I forgot to mention that the MCE Blaster now also works with the Pico 2, thanks to a user's patch. Okay, that's all for now. I hope you enjoyed the update on the MCE Blaster. Thanks for watching, and see you in a future video!